Hey guys, and thank you for joining us here at AfricaX5.tv New York edition. Now, exclusively today, we have Omara Fashion, whose brand is African Print Streetwear. I'm so excited to see what it's about. Jose, thank you so much for joining us here today. How are you?
I'm good. I'm so happy to be here.
Lovely to have you here. So let's talk about fashion. I can instantly see it's full of history, full of imagination, designs, everything.
Yeah.
Talk to me about that. How did you know about it?
So let me start by saying, you know, Africans, we have a history of slavery. You know, our ancestors have always had a sense of color and style. I mean, going back to Cleopatra and Nefertiti, it's ancestral. You know, the idea that we as Africans love to dress well. And so I think Omara Fashion is, it's about color. It's about like an ancestral heritage that is vibrant. This is kind of a story that goes against the Western narrative that we are rolling around in dust in Africa with flies around us. You know, there's this really kind of watered down, derogatory narrative about Africans and what comes out of the continent. And so I feel like right now there's like this new surge of creatives coming from the continent, and I'm meeting them in New York and back in South Africa as well. And it's kind of an exciting time to be an African creative in the world, because we're coming out and we're showing people that Africa is colorful. We have humor, we have vibrancy, we have stories, we have history, and it pushes against kind of like a Western narrative of what Africans are. And I think Omara Fashion kind of is that alternative narrative to what other people in the South think about Africa, in the North think about Africa.
So you originally grew up in Cape Town, which is amazing. Talk to me a little bit about your history and before you started Omara Fashion.
Okay, so you know the history about South Africa, you know, apartheid and all of that. So I grew up in a segregated neighborhood my whole life, and I grew up in a colored township. So you know, we grew up not with a lot. Both my parents didn't finish high school, and I was the first in my immediate family that went to college and also went to grad school. So I come from a family that's very loud, very opinionated, and I'm rolling my eyes for some time. I'm like, why are y'all giving me so much opinions right now? So I come from this, you know, this kind of township where my grandmother's house was kind of like the cultural like hub. A lot of gossip, a lot of stories, a lot of people passing through, and I grew up with my grandmother's porch kind of being like this evolving social cycle and circle of people coming through and talking and sharing stories, and that's kind of what I think about when I think about how I grew up. And you know, when you grow up in a township, you grow up with it's a disadvantaged community. You know, you have no access to healthcare and education, struggling and that kind of thing. So I think in my community, I was kind of, it's sad, I think that I was kind of an outlier in the sense that I got a scholarship to come to NYU and I'm here now, but for, you know, most girls in my township, the story is very different and kind of breaks my heart a little bit, but that's why we do what we do, so we can elevate the exposure of our communities and show really what comes out of these communities that the government has kind of gotten.
So Cape Town and New York City, there's clashing cultures, but they're so different as well. Talk to me, how did you find the culture shock? What was the biggest shock for you?
Oh no, where do I start? I came to grad school at NYU and my master's in public policy and international development. And so when I came here, I got an Oprah scholarship to come to NYU. And so I was the scholarship kid, right? And I kind of like had its own stigma attached to it. Fun side story. But what I found was that I went to school with, especially my first year, with a lot of white privileged Americans who have traveled to Africa for a summer and come back and think that they understand development frameworks on the continent. And I was shocked. I was shocked at the amount of arrogance there was, the amount of entitlement there was around the African experience. And that's why I got the scholarship. I was that voice in the room, and yes, you know, you become kind of a black token. But I found, I think my first experience here was, I surprised by how little Americans have lived on the continent and how much they had to say about what happens on the continent. So I was, it was kind of my first culture shock. And of course the food was a different issue also. In my house we ate rice every day, stews every day, cabbage stew, tomato stew, carrot stew, all of the stews. And so you come here and it's like lettuce and broccoli, you know, so it's like it takes a second to get used to it. But yeah, I think food and then just the way I think Americans think about Africa was a shock to me.
Now currently with the US, there is so much politics going on, particularly with black females and males. What's your opinion on it?
Ask that again. Okay, ask me that again.
So currently with the US, there is so much politics going on regarding race, particularly with black females and males. What's your opinion on it?
I think it's an old story. It's a historical story. It started with Africans coming here without wanting to. This country is built on deep racial trauma. You can't enslave a whole people and think that there's going to be peace and justice. That is just not how the world works. I advocate for, you know, for reparations. Our people need to get our land back. We need to get ownership back into the hands of black people. I think this country, right now what's happening, this hate has always been there. And I'm woke and I'm white and I know this has always been there. While Obama was the president, I think it was a little bit more subversive. People weren't as brave to talk about the hatred that they have in their hearts. But now they feel justified because the man in the White House kind of, you know, low-key, high-key, perpetuates that same kind of hatred towards black bodies. So I'm standing here and I'm thinking to myself, why are we all surprised about this? The KKK have been around. They've been having rallies all these years they've had it, right? It's just now they're coming out into the forefront, into the public eye. I'm not surprised by it. I'm saddened by it. And I'm scared a little bit about what's happening in the world. But I do think that we as a people have been through many atrocities. And I think this is just one of those where we're going to come out on top and know. I think we know how to fight. We know how to advocate for ourselves. I'm encouraged by the Black Lives Matter movement. I'm a part of it. I am it. And so I think there's space for us to really do something for this movement.
I feel that you've done a really good thing with creating something that inspires you and that's something that's your history. So, well, have you faced any challenges setting up something that kind of sheds a light, positive light as well, on African clothing?
Meeting my fashion plan?
Yeah.
I think, so number one, you know, when you're a creative, African creative, normally you're an outcast to those communities because Africans don't like to normally say like, encourage the creatives. We like to have doctors and lawyers and economists and people who have very predictable careers. And I think African creatives have a challenging time. I'm sure you can speak to that too, that, you know, we tend to be questioned a lot more, people think it's not serious. So I think that's been a challenge building the business this side. There's a whole community here in Brooklyn, in Queens, in the Bronx of African creatives that are like, yo, just like killing it right now in New York, globally. So I think it's important to be part of a community where you're connected. But I think that's been one of the challenges. It's just like people, when you start out, people won't take your work seriously until you take it seriously and you carry your work with that kind of seriousness and urgency like every day. So I think that's just kind of part of what it means to be an African
And I think that's worked in your favor because now you've got your own business, which is doing really well.
Yeah.
So what is the direction that you want to take on Mara Fashion? Where do you want to see it in, let's say, 5 years?
Yeah. So Mara Fashion is a street style. It's a. If you think about a Mara, you really think about like a dope woman that owns her body, that owns her blackness. My style is about the woman owning her body. I don't dress for the male gaze. It's not about men looking at me. It's about me feeling good in my way. And so in the next 5 years, I'm hoping to actually start a small factory in my township. I have so many relatives that sew and work in factories, so I'm really hoping that I can raise the funds to kind of build a small co-op or what's called in my township, and I can have the clothes manufactured at home. So that's kind of one way I'm thinking about it will go, and I think I will also try to design an aesthetic that is kind of easy, flowy. Something that's like New York street style, piece with like some African township vibe. So that's typically how my styles will look, and I'm hoping that over the next couple of years, I will have very limited additions in all of my styles. I don't think I'm going to be in all the storefronts necessarily. I think my brand is very much like, you know, 10 looks per season, very limited edition, and I'm hoping to kind of expand on that kind of business model over the next couple of years.
And you spoke to me about it being a street brand and kind of promoting that. Why street? What is it about street that inspires your collection?
Well, I'm from the streets.
Number one.
You know, I grew up, like my grandmother had this rule in the house that we can't play in the house if the sun is out. So we always had to be outside, playing in the trees, walking around, like, you know, playing at the neighbor's house, you know, the ones we were allowed to go to, because, you know, they had to be shortlisted. So I feel like I grew up, like, outside. I grew up, like, in the township outside in the streets in Cape Town. And even the work that I'm doing here is really good. My social justice work is all based in schools here. So I've worked in East Flatbush, I've worked in Brownsville, I've worked in the South Bronx. So my whole aesthetic, my whole experience is about the community. It's about uplifting our community. And so I think it made so much sense that my style would kind of speak to the work that I've always been doing. And that's kind of like grassroots, community-based, street fashion, street style, because that's kind of where my heart is. And that's the story I know how to tell. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
So what would you tell your younger self? Because you seem so confident and sure of yourself now. But what would you tell your younger self if you knew the direction you was headed?
Wow. That's a really good question. I never thought my life would end up here. It's so unusual. I don't even think my family thought I would make it this far. And so I would say to my younger self, you are going to have an amazing life. Don't worry. Don't be scared. Study hard. Love yourself. Love your body. And that everything is going to be okay. I think growing up, there was a lot of fear. Am I going to make it out of here? You know? And so, I'm getting a little emotional about it. But yeah. I think that's like the truth of my story, which is like I never really knew if I was going to make it out of the township, if I was going to make it out of that public school system. And I did. So I think another aspect of what I would tell my younger self is to embrace myself, embrace my body, and love me. Love me. I think self-love is the power of agency that we as black women have to own. And I think we have to stop internalizing these really sad, broken narratives about the black female body, because we all know that everyone wants to have this black body. That's why we have this whole like culture of like big booties and, you know, and enlarged like breasts and big lips and big hair. That's all blackness, you know. So it's like they've taught us to hate ourselves, low-key wanting to be us. So it's like, you know, like I think this is time for us to reverse that narrative and say, I'm gonna love all of that bigness and all of that curviness. It's gorgeous. Y'all know it, we know it, so why are we playing? That's it.
Chesley, that's beautiful. You are a role model, and I can just certainly see good things coming your way. So thank you so much for joining us here today.
Thank you so much. You're gorgeous. Thank you.